see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Welcome to the It's in Queens podcast. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons. And each week, I bring you the voices of Queens, the people, the places, the everyday faces that are part of the fabric of our fantastic borough. Lately, I've been focusing on reopenings, where you can now go in person or where you'll soon be able to go to. As the vaccination rates rise and new COVID cases drop here in New York City, hopefully we're on the path to full recovery sooner rather than later. And as we look ahead, I thought, well, it might be nice to take a look back. And I don't mean at this past year. I mean for decades, if not centuries. Whenever I'm on vacation or I take road trips, my husband has always found historic sites to visit. Homes off the beaten path that were once home to artists or presidents or other notable figures. I think we've often visited, I'd say, most presidential libraries while we've been on the road. And we've even visited homes designed by famous architects. But frankly, if you want to take a tour through history, you really do not have to go far because so much is right here in our backyard of Queens. Queens has farmsteads and mansions and architecturally significant community dwellings. The Images of America book series by Arcadia Publishing celebrates the history of neighborhoods, towns, and cities across the United States and uses archival photographs to showcase the distinctive stories from the past that shape the character of communities today. Well, just out this season is a new book, Historic Houses of Queens, and it's written by a very familiar voice on this podcast. No, not me, but the one, the only, Rob MacKay. Rob is a longtime award-winning community journalist who, as my listeners know, works for the Queens Economic Development Corporation, and he also launched the Queens Tourism Council. His interest in writing this book grew organically after he became a trustee of the Queens Historical Society. And as you pore through this book, you'll likely discover quite a few things you never knew about Queens, or that you knew did not know that was on your block, possibly a house that was just around the corner and you always wondered about its history. So I urged Rob to come on today to talk about the book and also about one home from a popular TV show from the 70s. Rob MacKay, welcome to the It's in Queens podcast. Now, before I get to the book, let's talk about you. You and Chris Donovan previously hosted this podcast, but for new listeners, give us some insight into who Rob MacKay is.
Sure. First of all, I want to say thanks for having me on and thanks for dealing with my funny schedule. But my dirty little secret is that I was born and raised in Brooklyn. I discovered Queens at about age 21 when I started teaching English to immigrants, English as a second language in Woodside, while I was going to New York University at night, taking classes at NYU at night. I was working for an English language school that had branches in Woodside, Jackson Heights, and Corona. And before I knew it, I was exploring the borough. Then I was renting an apartment in the borough. A little bit later, I owned an apartment in the borough. I got married in the borough. I raised two kids in the borough. I've held a number of jobs that were always in the borough. Or I should say in Queens. And about 9 or 10 years ago, I started working at the Queens Economic Development Corporation, where we started the Queens Tourism Council, which is what I run. It's kind of on hiatus because of COVID, but it's about to come roaring back. And I basically, I fell in love with the borough. I really do love it. I think it's a great place to live, work, raise children. I think I'll probably die here.
Wait, what was it about?
You don't really have control over that, but, I joined the Queens, the board of the Queens Historical Society, a couple of years ago. Always been interested in history. I've always been a huge reader, and I've done a lot of writing. I would say last year, really maybe last March, when COVID was approaching, and it became obvious that New York City was about to sort of go on lockdown, I came up with the idea that I could write a book about how wonderful Queens is, all the places you can go, and I would write it during the pandemic, and then the pandemic would end, my book would publish, people could read the book and go to all, they'd have all that pent up energy and they could go and visit all of these wonderful Queens places. But I pitched it to Arcadia Publishing, which, as you know, they focus on historical, on the history of towns or the history of trends or the history of things like immigration to an area. And so after I pitched it, I had a meeting with the editors and they said, this has to be historic. You can only talk about historic houses. If some of them happen to be museums or places you can visit, that's great. But it has to be historic, and they have a 180 minimum limit of photos. So they're basically formulaic. You have to have at least 180 photos. And they have to pass their muster, and then you write captions of the photos. And so I accepted it. I said, this is still great, you know, and so I signed the contract with them and everything. And then it was kind of off to the races, because finding 180 historical photos of houses, some of which were built in the 1600s, it's kind of hard to find any high quality photos. And they actually rejected a lot of them, but thanks to the fact that I'm in this job that I have, I know a lot of people, and people like the Richmond Hill Historical Society gave me photos, Greater Astoria Historical Society, the Douglaston Historical Society, all the houses, the historic houses, individuals gave me photos. And I was able to, the book actually has 200 pictures or images of old Queens.
So you touched on a lot. I've got a lot of follow-up questions.
Sorry,
for you.
I didn't. No. You turned me on and I don't stop.
I do want to go back to something. Okay. What was it? We're going to get to the book right after this, but what was it about history? Like, why have you always loved history?
Well, you know, I actually, my father and grandfather were history buffs. And I grew up in Brooklyn, where a lot of my relatives, where we go way back, and we're all, you know, like, we're, my family members are buried in all the cemeteries in Brooklyn, and you walk through streets and it's where relatives lived and stuff like that. There's part of it is just a quest for knowledge. I have to read like 4 or 5 hours a day, just because of me. And history fascinates me. If I really scratch the surface, it's fascinating to think that all these things really happened. And you also learn a lot about yourself and sort of human nature and what we're doing on this planet. The question that really no one has an answer, but you learn a lot about, you know, how we lived, why we lived, and everything else. Plus, there's learning history. You also learn about the, you know, personalities and stuff. But in a book like this, you learn a lot about architecture, designs for houses, trends, demographic trends, who was moving where, you know, what jobs, what companies were being born and flourishing. And so you really do learn a lot about history. And then there are also a lot of these stories have anecdotes because crazy people lived in them. So it's really interesting all around. It touches a lot of different bases.
So give me an example of something that surprised you along the way as you research this.
Geez. Where to be? Well, I was happy to find out that the oldest house in New York City that is still a private dwelling is in Queens, which is to say there are some that are older, but they're either museums or they were torn down or whatever. But we have the oldest house in New York City that someone actually lives in. That was kind of interesting. I learned a lot about Queens was very much farmland. And then in some cases, there were one person who made a lot of money and then took it on himself basically to install the gas lines and the electric lines, pave the roads, build the houses, get the city to build a railroad station and all that. There's a lot of stuff that you just don't really, you walk around Queens and once you read this book, or after I was researching this book, wherever I would go, I could just walk down the street and be like, oh, so this is why. And you look at the certain houses and I'm saying, oh, this is because it was built at this time when this was, you know, famous, when this was the rage, or this was built because, you know, the subway had just gone out to this stop and everyone wanted to go there. Or, you know, you go to the Rockaways and you see dilapidated houses and you're like, oh, so I know that the Rockaways was basically the Hamptons before mass production of the car and people could go further out. Because, you know, there was a time when the richest people in New York City would build mansions in Rockaway for the seaside breezes, really. The other thing is that working with these people, talking to these different people that love history and that helped me out so much on this book, I learned that there are a lot of really nice people out there.
Have you personally toured or visited every spot that's in this book?
I would probably say yes. Obviously, some of the houses are destroyed. The house that you see on the cover is actually that burned in a fire. It's now basically where Terminal A of LaGuardia Airport is. So I can kind of say I've been there. I've flown over it. But between all the houses that are still there and the areas where the houses that existed, there's also a fair amount in the book on historical districts. And Queens, of course, has its fair share of planned communities. And in that case, I can't say I've been in every house in the plan in the district, but I've, of course, been in the districts.
So what's interesting, too, is that you describe some hidden treasures. Can you give us an example of one?
You know, people know about this, but there's a neighborhood called Flushing Broadway or Broadway Flushing, which is a historic district. And it's not really in Flushing. It's more, you know, Flushing on Northern Boulevard then becomes Murray Hill. And then if you go north, there's this neighborhood with these absolutely beautiful houses that were all built basically by two different developers. And there was all this zoning laws that happened at the time, which, for example, you had to be, I think it was 35 feet back. You couldn't build your house until you were 35 feet off the sidewalk. You couldn't build an actual fence, but you could put in a bush fence. And then knowing the time of the people, it was mostly Italian American. So there's a lot of Mediterranean style houses. And then the fact that there's now a Korean community coming in. And the Korean community doesn't understand the historic cases, and there's all this tension going on in the neighborhood. First of all, that neighborhood is just a beautiful walk because it's just great houses, great front yards and backyards. There's the history to it, and then there's also the modern day tension. You know, like, for example, it was, it's the laws are such that you, can't block anyone's view of the all the way down the street. Like things like that. You're like, what the heck? And there's a civic association with a couple of crazy old ladies who walk around and knock on your door if you're not doing it, if you're doing something wrong. So,
well, it's election season. A lot of people knock on our doors.
Yeah, you get different kind of crazy people.
So one other thing, there was a chapter that I loved, and mm-hmm. I could go one direction or another. I'm going to go the other direction. You mentioned dream houses and nightmares. Give us an example of a nightmare.
You know, that's actually kind of interesting because that's another, there's sort of an inside story behind that. The editors, I wanted to just have chapters, just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10. And they said each chapter had a name, had to have a name. And I also wanted to just start the first book with the first house would be the oldest, and we just go straight to the newest in the book. And they said, no, it has to start at the top of Queens. And then go clockwise around and go back up the Queens. So it starts at East Elmhurst, and then it goes out to Flushing and Bayside and around. So the last houses are basically a story, a Steinway. Now they know what they're doing. I don't know what I'm doing. But after having laid out the whole book, I had to make up chapter names. And the one that you're talking about is the Richmond Hill section, I believe, mm-hmm. Where there are all those wonderful Victorian houses. And a lot of them were built by wealthy people for their dream houses. There's actually the story of one guy who used to ride by on his horse, and he fell in love with the neighborhood, had to have a house there. One of those houses ended up being like a bad luck, like a jinxed house. Someone, I guess, did a voodoo hex on it. And it had, you know, it had a whole series of bad things, including deaths and divorces, et cetera, et cetera. And people wouldn't visit because they thought it was haunted and stuff like that. And so because that house is in that chapter, I came up with the name Dream Houses to Nightmares. Yeah.
And I will say your follow up to this could be Haunted Houses of Queens.
You know, maybe a way to in 400 years. This is covers 400 years, so maybe 400 years from now, I'll write another one.
So I want people to open the book, and by the way, I should say the title is Historic Houses of Queens, in case they're looking for this online.
We played it straight.
So. So I don't want to go into too many details because I would love people to pick up the book and then decide to walk around Queens or travel around Queens. But if you want people to have a starting point, you know, if they want to visit some of these places, where should they start? Because you know Queens better than most people.
Well, you know, a lot of it depends on what your tastes are. But, you know, Flushing has historic houses from every century. We have their historic houses that were built in the 1600s, 1700s, 1800s, and 1900s. Then on top of that, it has the oldest Hindu temple in the United States, although that's not in the book, and the whole oldest Sikh gurdwara or temple in the United States. So if you wanted a nice sort of variety, you could see, you know, the what were farmhouses built. You know, the history of Queens, the Dutch and the English were the first Europeans. So the oldest houses are Dutch colonials and British colonials. The Germans showed up later. So then there are all these Germans and there. Then we had Italians with the Mediterranean style and all these other, there's an arts and crafts style architecture that was famous there. But, you know, I would say Flushing is a fantastic place. There's a place called Addesley Park, which is a personal favorite. It's where it was at one time, it was called Black Hollywood East because so many prominent African-American entertainers lived there. People like Count Basie, Ella Fitzgerald, and Lena Horne lived there. A whole bunch of jazz people that you might not have heard of, but you've heard their songs lived there. I should mention Billie Holiday was there. And then a bunch of athletes, including Jackie Robinson, who's a personal favorite of my family because we were all Brooklyn Dodgers fans. Roy Campanella, who was also on the Brooklyn Dodgers. He was the catcher. He lived there. Famous boxer, W.E.B. Du Bois, a couple of the civil rights leaders lived there. Plus, it's a beautiful neighborhood with great architecture, great front lawns, very well kept. And it's just something to walk around there and just think about all the different jazz greats who are living there at one time.
And for the older generation, this is where I, of course, enjoyed this. You do bring up something which I found fascinating. It is about Archie Bunker's house, where it is and where it isn't.
So that's my kicker. The last photo in the book is of Archie Bunker's house. Now, you look like you're not as old as me, but I grew up watching All in the Family. Archie Bunker was that guy. There was All in the Family, and there was the Jeffersons, which is the spin-off TV show. Oh, and Maude too, if you remember Maude.
And then 227.
You know about this more. So I had a grandmother who we called Maude, and her personality wasn't that much different from the woman on that show. Anyway, if you haven't seen it, Archie Bunker was the longest running TV series of its time. It was through the 1970s. Archie Bunker was a bigot. He was so bigoted, like it was so exaggerated. He hated everyone. He hated blacks, he hated Jews, he hated hippies, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And he was always talking about it and talking about it in such stupid, awkward ways that it was hilarious. I thought it was hilarious. It's probably too much for modern day. He'd probably be canceled now. But anyway, on the show, they claimed that he lived on Hauser Street in Astoria. Now, anybody who knows Astoria pretty well would know that there is no Hauser Street. It turns out that Hauser Street is the name of the boulevard in Los Angeles where CBS Studios was located. So it's where they filmed the show. The other thing is that in the opening credits, Archie and his wife are singing a song, and they basically just have a camera panning that takes you through Queens and then down a block, and then it makes a turn into his house. And that's supposed to be his house. The actual house is in Glendale. It's actually right at the Glendale-Woodhaven border. And there's a woman that lived there for about 40 years, and she was just, people were constantly knocking on her door and everything else. But those of us who know the borough will tell you that that Glendale is what, 10 miles from Astoria? So I think it's fair to say that Hollywood got it wrong. Wrong, 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 and wrong. Astoria, there's no Hauser Street. Astoria is not Glendale. Queens is not known for its bigots, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
So we've got just about a minute or so left, and sure. I want to go back to something you said at the very, very beginning of this interview about the Queens Tourism Council, that it's coming, about to come roaring back. Can you let our listeners know what's in store?
Well, the Queens Tourism Council has been around for about 8 years, and in terms of membership, about half of them, 25 are hotels. We have probably 50, 60 members. The rest are anything, you name it, whether it's museums, oratorio societies, sculpture gardens. And we promote everything through the It's in Queens brand, which is very, very friendly with this podcast, which, what's the name of this podcast again?
The It's in Queens podcast.
Oh, okay. So anyway, things are opening up. The restaurants that have made it, I think they're good for, you know, we're going to have a really big summer. Rockaway is going to explode this summer with fun and excitement. Some of the stuff is still online, but there's a hybrid thing going on. We're having live shows. We're having live outdoor shows. There's a lot going on. As a guy who follows what's going on in this borough very closely, I can tell you, February was depressing, but now we're in May and we've got new art shows. We've got new dance. We've got outdoor theater. We've got outdoor. We have outdoor movies and outdoor live theater. My family, we tried to rent a house in the Rockaways this summer in August via Airbnb, and everything was sold out. So that makes me think that there's going to be a lot of activity at the Rockaways this summer. And why not? It's a great place. So I really feel that there's a light at the end of the tunnel, you know? As my friend says, there's a light at the end of the tunnel, and it isn't a train coming after you.
So for our listeners, if they would like to pick up Historic Houses of Queens, how can they get a copy?
Sure. It is Arcadia Publishing, and their website is, they play it straight too. It's arcadiapublishing.com. So I should do it right now to make sure, but if you go to arcadiapublishing.com, there's a search thing. You could put in Rob MacKay, or Historic Houses of Queens, that would do it. My last name is not pronounced like it's spelled, thanks to Gaelic. It's M-A-C, capital K-A-Y. I guess if you just Googled Rob, M-A-C-K-A-Y, and Historic Houses of Queens, it would come up.
And I guess as I wrap up, I should ask, now that we are rebounding, we're reopening, do you and Chris Donovan expect to just kick me out of this seat in the near future? what's in store?
No, you are doing such a good job with it that we hope that you, we hope that you keep it until 400 years from now when I can come on and talk about my second book on Historic Houses of Queens.
Rob MacKay, thank you once again for joining me for this interview. And for our listeners, stay with this podcast because every week Rob still provides the weekly report on activities and events. And as he just noted, many more are happening in person. Although I'm seeing a lot of cultural institutions in particular are continuing virtual as well. A nice mix for, you know, depending on what you like, there's something for everyone. Rob, thanks again.
No, thank you, Jeff. You're doing a great job.
That was my conversation with Rob MacKay of the Queens Economic Development Corporation and Queens Tourism Council. The book, again, is by Arcadia Publishing. I also was very happy to see that Rob featured homes where Jackie Robinson lived and also a number of jazz greats. I had never realized how widespread this was until I started working with Flushing Town Hall years ago and I saw their amazing jazz trail map. Much of it shows how walkable this borough is. I don't want to give it all away. You have to get the book, and then you can discover where these places are. We're about to celebrate Memorial Day, a 3-day weekend and the unofficial start to summer. So Rob has been very busy lately as he's seeing in-person activity pick up. He sifts through events each week and picks out a few that are worth checking out. And each week, he provides us with a report that gives you advice on what you should add to your calendar. But this week, Rob has stepped aside, and so we've got a special guest giving this week's report.
Hi, everybody. This is Asha MacKay. I'm a student at NYU who lives in Sunnyside and simply loves Queens. Rob is promoting his book right now, so I have the chance to tell you about some great things that are about to take place in our beloved borough. First up is an LGBTQ+ Pride event at Queens Center on May 24th at 6 p.m. Set for Center Court on the second floor, this unofficial Pride Month kickoff will feature a fair amount of giveaways with tenant retailers and other activities. But the main event is a concert by Jay Horde, a Grammy-winning singer, songwriter, all-around performer, and fashion icon. An artist-in-residence at National Sawdust in Brooklyn, the eclectic Horde does Black church, Broadway, jazz, electronic tunes, and just about anything else. And he can do it in a red sequined jumpsuit and a full-length onesie. The other big news is that the Blues Brothers will be at Radio Park in Astoria from May 27th to June 26th. We talked about this during a previous podcast. Patrons drive in or sit down at a picnic table and watch the classic film on a huge screen while a professional troupe and a multi-piece band perform. Those are two items, but Queens offers so much more. Jeff can help you with the extra details. Thanks, Jeff, and I hope to see everybody in the borough soon.
And coming up next week, as we head into the Memorial Day weekend, I'm sure you're thinking about the beach or parks or just getting any place outdoors where you could have a barbecue. So as we head into these warmer months, and it feels like we're already there, I'll be talking with more folks about these outdoor activities. And next week, I'll bring you details about a wonderful place called Camp Rockaway. You will get pampered at the beach. If you're looking for something to do, a great starting point is the Queens Tourism Council's It's in Queens website, itsinqueens.com. You also should sign up for the Queens Economic Development Corporation's newsletter at queensny.org. That way you get notified right in your inbox. And as always, I say this every week, remember that no matter where you are in Queens, just tag us on Twitter. Use the hashtag It's in Queens, and also follow us on Twitter at It's in Queens. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons, and I'll be back next week with another episode of the It's in Queens podcast.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.